first ever unexpected conversation. It's unexpected, so we have no idea what's going to happen in this space. But we know that because Victoria is the place that it is, and because everyone showed up here with a particular imagination and desire, we know that whatever happens here will be awesome. I'm just going to give a very brief overview about why the heck would we host an unexpected conversation at all. And then I'm going to turn it over to my three creative folks here, makers extraordinaire, to just briefly introduce themselves, who they are, and anything else they want to say. They've all told me they hate talking about themselves. So we'll try and move into questions and dialogue just as soon as we can. I want to keep it as flowy and open as possible. So if something is set up here and you want to say something, just join right in. So it's meant to, you know, we've got rows because, you know, sometimes rows work better for everyone to see. But really, this is meant to be, like the thing says, not a panel discussion, but a conversation. So if there's anything that comes up for you, anything that you want to ask or say in the moment, honestly, just say it. If you want to be on camera and record your sentiments, you can join us up at the front. There is one video camera, but if you just want to say what you want to say into the conversation, it'll be picked up by the ambient microphone. So I want to thank a number of folks before we get started. Obviously, Studio Robazo for saying yes, we're going to host this this first unexpected conversation. Our friends at Philips, who are providing beer to you at no cost to any of us, so three cheers for Philips. And my friend Jason Giel from Stream of Consciousness, which is an amazing live streaming, only in Victoria, only place in the world that does this kind of thing. We're not live streaming today, but he's come, and I wanted to just thank him and Stream of Consciousness for donating his time. So what is an unexpected conversation, and why the heck would we want to have one? One of the things I know for sure about Victoria is that we are all doing awesome things, creative things in our little sectors, in tech, in the arts, in the makers, in the nonprofit, in for-profit, in architecture. We're all doing all this amazing stuff all the time. And we export our genius to the world. People around the world can tell you all the awesome things are happening about Victoria and in Victoria. They can tell you about what's happening in the tech scene. They can tell you about what's happening in the art scene. But one of the things we don't do enough, and this is the whole point of having these unexpected conversations, is to bring people together who wouldn't necessarily otherwise be sitting together. Something in common, but not much in common. And see what comes when we probe and try to understand more about each other's silos. Not that you guys are living in silos. But there's still that there's all this awesomeness, there's pockets of awesomeness. And the whole point of this unexpected conversation series is to rip open the pocket seams and let everything fall out to the ground and mesh together in interesting ways. So I don't know what'll come of this. The series is really meant to be crowdsourced, so I took a stab at two things I thought would be interesting. Conversations number 3 and 4. The dates have been set just for one concrete thing, but on the card on your chair, conversations 3 and 4, the topics, the venues, everything is to be determined by those who want to do something. So if you've got an idea that comes to you in the next, I don't know, 3 hours or 6 months, email me and we'll make it happen. So with that, I'll invite Melanie to begin, and just 5 minutes about what you think people need to know about you as a maker.
Yeah, use
the mic.
Yeah. Okay. I do have a loud voice, but...
Is this thing on?
I do have a loud voice, so I'll try and talk quietly so I don't blow you all away. My normal voice, I'm actually louder than the microphone. I'm Melody Reynolds, and thank you so much, Lisa, for that wonderful introduction. I'm so excited and thankful to have been invited to speak here tonight. The Robazo Studio holds a close place in my heart because this is actually where some of the tools that my company uses are manufactured. I am a maker of clean, vegan, chemical-free, cruelty-free, so good you can eat them cosmetics. And now how do I make those things? That's what people ask me all the time is, how do you make that? Well, I started out, I've been in the industry for about 16 years, and I started becoming relatively disenchanted with the products that I was putting on my body. I'd had some health concerns, I have had family members with health concerns, and I'm sure you've all heard the old adage, what you put on your body goes into your body. And so if you're using products that have ingredients that potentially can cause cancer, just because you're not ingesting it doesn't mean that it's not dangerous. And so I took that one step further and decided to clean up my entire life. And as a result of that, I decided to start a company, and that is my end goal, is to create a healthy product for women and men everywhere who want to use a cosmetic that is fun but is also safe. When I started making products, I started out very simply with things like lip balms and cheek balms, and these are things that you could actually make in your kitchen. And that was the way that I started. And I still continue to do. I teach workshops where I actually teach you how to make your own products. I'm probably gonna cry because I get really, really passionate about what I do.
Tears are very welcome.
I know. I don't think I've ever spoken in public without crying. It's just one of those things. It's like the Kool-Aid man, right? You know he's gonna crash through the wall and yell, "Oh yeah!" You know I'm gonna cry. I'm very passionate about sharing. I'm very passionate about empowerment, not just for women, but for all people that have ever been marginalized. And that includes men, it includes different cultures, it includes everything. And how can you take something so frivolous as cosmetics and empower people with it? Well, this is how. You teach them how to have a choice. We, as Canadians, and I hope you can all agree with me, or maybe not, maybe I'm super crazy right wing, but we tend to be a little bit apathetic, right? How are you are really pumped about the election? A few, right? We gotta get more pumped about stuff like this. And the reason that we're not pumped is because we feel like it doesn't matter. The choices that we make don't matter. Well, what I wanted to tell everyone is that you do have a choice. And the tiny choices that you make every day evolve and grow into a mountain of wonderful empowerment and acceptance in the world. And so, when I started teaching people how to make their own skincare products, what was so fun for me was that I could walk into someone's kitchen with nothing and show them how to make an entire regime where they could clean and care for their body and their babies and their husbands and their aunts and uncles and their pets with just the stuff in their kitchen. And that was incredibly empowering for me and also for them. And so I decided to take it one step further and do something that I love, because I am a makeup artist. I've always been an artist, and I've always enjoyed the colorful and exciting and fun side of makeup, and actually took it to that level. I started making products in my kitchen. You wouldn't want to see it. It's not a great kitchen, but that's where everything started. And I sourced local ingredients and organic ingredients, and I sourced ingredients from faraway places because not everything comes from where you need it to come from. I was lucky enough to live in a time where I understand what free trade means, and that just because I can earn a good living making what I'm making means that everyone should be allowed to earn a good living making what they're making. So all of the pigments and micas and things that I use, which all of you ladies will recognize from looking on what your makeup is made of, they all come from fair trade sources. And then when I grew a little bit bigger, I was lucky enough to find another Canadian company, another maker, who isn't in this province, but in another province, and they are now making my products for me. So I've promoted myself. So I am no longer toiling in my kitchen. Well, occasionally I'm there. And then my mandate as a person who owns a company here in Victoria is to expose other companies. I'm a big believer in that I am only as good as the people that I'm surrounding myself with, so it is my absolute priority to surround myself with people that are way more awesome than I am, hence the panel here that you see. Only by doing that can we expand ourselves and grow into ourselves. And so when I was looking for solutions to make my product available to the masses here in Victoria, because you know there are so many of us, I wanted an interesting display solution, and that was actually how I got Andrew involved with my company. So we're a sustainable company, we're completely paperless, all of my packaging is sustainable, everything is biodegradable or reusable or recyclable at the very end. And so I wanted something that was completely within my value set, and Andrew was able to provide one, and Mark as well. Isn't this funny how we're all connected here? I love doing business in Victoria because we're such a tight-knit community, and the support that I've received here has been amazing, and I'm just so happy to be here.
All right, thank you for that introduction. Why don't we go to, Mark next. Tell us who you are and, round of applause. Very good.
Hello. I don't do a lot of public speaking, so I have some notes in case I get lost. So my name is Mark DeMontney, and I come from a long line of woodworkers. I was one of those kids that was always running around with a hammer, banging things, taking things apart, and generally not being able to put them back together. Which is ironic, because as an adult, I find that I'm putting a lot of things back together. With the internet, you know, any problem you have, you can probably find a YouTube video. It shows you how to do it. And it's great to be empowered to look at a problem or have a friend approach you with a problem and put it together. So I kind of have four different facets to my work life. I have a permaculture landscaping company called Living Landscapes and two partners. And we do edible landscape design. I have a art installation company called Of Trees. And we're actually based out of Vancouver. I have a partner over there. And we collect wood from construction sites and save it in our warehouse and do one big art installation every year, usually at the festival or something like that. I also am the general manager for a company that sells specialty equipment to restaurants. And that equipment helps the restaurant reduce their carbon footprint. So they're kind of all in alignment. The fourth thing that I do is some consulting, design, and woodworking work. And that's, I guess, partially why I'm on the panel here today. These four separate ventures that kind of make up my income and my day-to-day work life are all linked by the concept of regenerative design. Regenerative being kind of like the step after sustainable, because really, obviously, what we want isn't just to be able to maintain and sustain. We want to regenerate. We want to find those levers we can pull to really kind of give back. So a couple interesting design things with regenerative. I like to think cradle to cradle whenever I can. That's a great name of a book, and it taught me all about it. So when we're looking at a product we're going to make, we don't want to just take all the ingredients and make the product. We also want to design what that product's going to be when it's done being the product. And looking at the materials we use almost as nutrients in the nutrient cycle, and then composting them after. Permaculture is kind of a buzzword many of you may have heard of. In 2012, I took my design certification out at our eco-village. It's really changed my life and how I look at things. So I basically kind of looked through that lens, and maybe there'll be some questions about that later, but it's a big topic. And it really affects basically everything you look at, because you start seeing a lot of possibilities where before it might have seemed a bit hopeless. So as part of the measure and sprout designs, that's the stuff I do for myself. I have a CNC machine, also kind of a buzzword nowadays. CNC stands for computer numerical control. So basically when you have a design in a computer, the CNC machine is the part that turns it into a real thing. And it's kind of one of the keystones of the maker movement. All 3D printers, laser cutters, plasma cutters, vinyl cutters, even your printer at home is basically using CNC technology to take something from a computer file and bring it into reality. I built mine in November last year, and since then I've just had kind of a steady flow of people contacting me through Craigslist and Use Victoria, including this gentleman, to make these really interesting products.
Seriously, that's how I found you.
Yeah.
Best rate in town.
Yeah, so the technology that comes with CNC usually is very cost prohibitive. People are charging over $100 an hour, and so kind of reclaiming that, using the power of the information on the internet to build these systems ourselves, we're able to kind of join the maker movement and decentralize where things come from. You don't have to order them from China. You know, we can make them here. And this technology is really empowering in that way. And the last thing I'll say is that the thing that really gets me excited and interested is the intersection between the maker movement and CNCs, which I don't find those two things to be sustainable on their own, but how we apply regenerative design to these really powerful tools to come up with solutions for the problems we have. So that's what gets me fired up.
Excellent. Andrew, what gets you fired up?
Well, it's interesting because everything that they've talked about is pretty much my core tenets of how I do things, which is amazing because I feel like we're a great team in that regard. So I'm Andrew. I run Studio Robazzo. which is where we are right now. We are a we're a multidisciplinary, holistic lifestyle design studio. Now, what does that even mean?
Yeah, I always try and describe you guys, and I can't.
It's so hard because we're trying to use design thinking to solve complex problems that cross boundaries. So no longer are you just an industrial designer or a graphic designer or an architect or whatever it is. You're using problem solving to do that. You have people that don't know where to go. Like Melody, if you wouldn't know where to go to get your displays.
No, in fact, I was going to you to ask you where to get them.
Exactly. So that's what we try to do, is problem solve for people to empower their businesses. In so doing, we're empowering ourselves. This whole thing, it's kind of an experiment, to be honest, has been about becoming incredibly dissatisfied with a previous way of being, a previous way of working, a previous way of living my life. You know, I come from Toronto. I lived there pretty much my whole life. I've worked all over the world. I used to be an architect. And I had a moment where I became so disenfranchised with how there was a disconnect between one, disciplines, and two, the physical object and the idea. And so that, when I moved here with Christina, who's my other business partner along with Sarah, that was the driving force. Like, how do we start to bridge boundaries to create brand new things, create new experiences? So that's what drives me. But novelty. But novelty not in the sake of trying to cover a lack of quality. It's novelty to try to embellish quality. That's honest. Like, what is honest design? Like, I could sit here for an hour and just ask questions because I don't know the answers. But they're questions that we need to think about. So yeah, that's what drives me.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Yeah, round of applause. So one of the things that I want to pick up on that is something that all three of you kind of address in one way or another, but I want to frame it like this. What is making in the 21st century? Because let's rewind 200 years to shoemakers and candle makers and people at home-based industries in the 17th and 18th centuries and earlier. That was making. And so it's not casting back 200 and 300 years. There are some similarities. So what does it mean to be a maker in the 21st century? And you know, address to all of you or anyone else or...
Who would like to take this one?
There's a lot of talk about the rewilding movement. I don't know if some of you have heard of that.
And tell us, in case we haven't all, what's the rewilding movement?
Getting out of the city, getting in touch with nature, getting in touch with the flows of nature. And when you were just asking us that question, I was thinking, yeah, our grandparents and their grandparents could fix their shoe, could sew their shirt, and we've kind of become disenfranchised from that. So I think the maker movement's almost like a relearning, as opposed to rewilding, the things that we should know how to do. You know, the oven's broken, I guess we should get a new oven, you know? that kind of thing, it happens a lot, it's amazing. And often, especially in the construction world, which I've got a lot of experience in, it's a lot cheaper to throw things out than it is to fix them. And it's unfortunate, but that's the machine that's driving all this waste, you know?
Hi again. I'm not going to cry this time.
I absolutely agree. And I mean, my industry is slightly different than Mark's and Andrew's, but still, the compelling thing is the idea of exactly what you said. People don't know how to do things for themselves anymore. Have you all noticed a resurgence of workshops? Doesn't matter what it is, somebody's putting on a workshop to teach you how to do something, and that's because we've forgotten. We've forgotten how to mend our own shirts and darn our own socks and churn our own butter. But somebody else will teach you, and that's exactly what it is. It's a relearning movement, and that's, I think, where makers like us truly thrive. Not because we want to make it to sell it to you, because we want to teach you how to make it. And that's a whole part for me anyway, and I know for Andrew, and I'm going to assume for Mark, is the idea that, you know, I make my living off of making things for other people, but I am more than happy to teach them how to make it themselves. Because that's sharing, and that's where, you know, I am going to cry again. That's sharing. And that is, you know, where the true heart of community lies, is sharing your skills with someone else so you all thrive.
But I'll also take almost like the devil's advocate here, and I don't want to see us just go blindly into that one direction, because that's a backtrack. It's like feeding onto a loop and you just end up where you started. Like, we have to take everything that we've learned through centralization with the mindset of decentralization and then try to create a new hybrid. And so that's where we're, like, I feel like where we're at is, how do we create hybrid systems that allow for both things to occur simultaneously? This one thing about being on Vancouver Island, you know, the whole notion of going back to the earth, going back to a green way of living, and the first initial idea for people is to run away from the city, run away from urbanity, run away from capitalism, go into the forest and basically become a, you know, 18th century peasant.
But that doesn't exist anymore.
That doesn't exist anymore because you can still have the internet.
Yeah.
So you have to create the hybrid version, otherwise you're lying to yourself, you know? And I see that a lot of people just reacting to something.
So let's pick up on that idea of making money being a maker. So part of the 21st century is what you've said, you know, teaching other people to make for themselves. But how, so I guess I have a two-part question. How do you make money being a maker? I mean, you've got four jobs. That's one thing. And what's it like to do business in Victoria as somebody who is self-defined as a maker? I mean, you were telling me before you export 85% of your product and only sell 15% locally. So let's push in a little bit to what it's like to be a maker in the 21st century in Victoria. How do you make stuff and make a living?
So I do find it interesting because, you know, Mark has four jobs. Andrew clearly has, it's undefined the amount of jobs that he has because no one really knows what he does. It's true, yeah. I myself actually have three companies that I run. So I don't know if I can define exactly what it's like to be a maker in terms of making money. It is. It's all about diversifying because, you know, I no longer are there, you know, 100 people in my village who all need me to cobble shoes for them, right? There are, you know, 3 billion people around the world, and some of them might want what I have and some of them might not. Now, more locally, you know, there is a very great local economy that is looking for locally made goods or locally sourced things, and that's fantastic. But as Lisa was saying, I found it so interesting that, yeah, only 15% of my customer base is actually locally here in Victoria. I'm much more popular other places, and I don't know what that is exactly. I really noticed that I have such a huge support network here. So my biggest supporters are here in Victoria. Most of my content is shared, yay social media, like social media is the new god, right? So all of my content is shared, all of my biggest supporters are here in Victoria, but my purchasers are other places. And now I don't know whether that is a community-based, sort of mass fever that we love what you're doing, but we're not buying yet, and then other people are purchasing. But again, here in Victoria is also where I'm teaching my workshops. So there is a much, you know, I'm more readily available to people that are here locally. And in terms of making a living being a maker in the 21st century, you know, I'm not a millionaire, which, you know, is no surprise. But I also don't want to be a millionaire. I can't speak for the other members on the panel. I would assume that we are, you know, I guess I shouldn't assume, but
we have a devil sitting here.
Yeah, we do, exactly. Doing what I do is fulfilling enough for me that I am very happy that the living that I make is able to sustain my family. But this definitely is not a career path for the faint of heart or someone who wants to be a millionaire, because it might not happen. Chances are, if you become a millionaire, it's not because of what you've made, it's because of what you've made of the company that you started when you wanted to make something to change the world.
That's a beautiful way of putting it. Yeah. So Mark and Andrew, what's it like to be a maker in Victoria in the 21st century, making a living? What's the local climate like here? And quite frankly, what can we do better as a community to support your ventures and all the ventures that everyone else in this room is undertaking as well?
I think Victoria is actually, I was just trying to think what is my answer to that. And it seems to be the perfect size. I just moved here 2 years ago from Vancouver, and the maker movement.
Welcome home.
Well, thank you. The maker movement there is alive and strong. You can almost get lost in the noise. Like, there's a lot of people doing a lot of very similar things. And I really get the sense that if, you know, I was in a smaller town, there wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't have made the connections I've made so far with the things I'm doing. So it really feels like right now, in particular, Victoria is the right size, the right climate. There's not so many people that, you know, you're going to get lost and drowned out in that buzz of the maker movement. It seems pretty good. I think having events like this is exactly what we need to kind of make the connections and the networking. And almost all of the work I procure in Victoria these days is through clients I've already got who find out I do something else. or, you know, just meeting so-and-so, you know, through a friend and whatnot. So it's really the way to go is old-fashioned networking. What does Victoria need?
Well, what does Victoria need to make making easier and better? And
well, it's interesting because this is the first time I've lived in a place where there's more creative people per capita than I've ever experienced in my life.
Yay!
But
someone tweet that. Is anyone tweeting? Tweet that.
But at the same time, it seems like nothing happens.
Tweet that part.
And I don't want to be rude about it, but like,
until Studio Rabazzo opened up. Yeah. Now there's always stuff.
You know, when we first moved here because it was the perfect location, like you were saying, size, demographics, the people, to creatively express yourself. But like, at the end of the day, there's not that many people really actively pushing.
It's a benefit.
It's also a benefit. Oh my God, thank God. No, I shouldn't actually be saying this now. This is bad. We're good, okay. I think the what's possible here is if we help each other and instill a little bit of competition, but not competition in the same sense of when you're living in New York or Toronto where you're competing for your survival. It's cooperation. Say that again. Co-opetition?
Yeah.
Okay, like that.
We're in
no, that's good.
Cooperating.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. That word. That's good. And then really figure out how to export these ideas, these products, these services off the island. Then this becomes a beautiful breeding ground for innovation and new ways of thinking. And at that, then you don't have to worry. You're tapping into a globalized world. You don't have to worry about, you know, I'm going to screw you over because I want what you have. That doesn't produce anything good. So that's what it needs. It needs to cooperate more, a little bit of competition, and a kick in the ass.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay, so how do we get that kick in the ass? Because I couldn't agree more. I mean, one of the reasons I wanted to become mayor of this fine town is exactly what you said. There's all this amazing stuff happening. So many pockets of amazingness. And yet, sometimes nothing happens anyway. So what? Any ideas from anyone? Yeah, how do we give ourselves a collective kick in the ass?
Hosting one of these events weekly.
Oh, good idea.
Oh, so more people involved in this and more people's ideas and raising more awareness.
Okay, a weekly unexpected conversation. Yeah. I might task you with that.
Do you want to head it up?
Yeah. Open table discussion, Dem Magazine.
Excellent. Okay, what else? What else will help us with a collective kick in the ass? Yeah.
I think on top of what Ashley says, I think action lists. Like, people actually really need to take action. I'm also new to Victoria. I've only been here a year and a half, and I've got 5 contracts right now, and one of the things that I have found is, yes, everybody's excited and everybody's talking. One of the things that I found here is that, as you said, Lisa, a lot of people in Victoria know, or sorry, outside of Victoria know how wonderful we are.
Yeah.
I don't think Victorians know how wonderful we are.
So
we have organizations here that are doing incredible work. I'm working with many of them.
They just need something proposed to them to actually act on.
Well, and they need to understand that if they can help this little company that wants to go global, they are going to put Victoria on the map in so many different programs. I mean, just two that I'm working with right now. I'm just going to name one because it's going to happen fairly soon is what we're doing. But has anybody heard of Fisheye Project? Young man who
Fisheye Project.
So the young man who defended his thesis from underwater
recently.
So Fisheye is getting more attention globally than locally.
Yes.
John Ballard, who found the Titanic, wants a private meeting. Mm-hmm. We've been invited to San Jose to present at IMAX for a panel of international IMAX producers. But we're not getting as much support here as we actually need, so we may actually have to leave Victoria to make the Fisheye Project a success.
Okay, and you know what? Let's pause there. I hear that all the time. I hear, so what's our collective problem? What's our collective opportunity? How can, I'm gonna turn it to the panel. How can we solve these problems? Kelly's got an answer at the back, and then we'll come back to the panel. How can we solve this? And yell so we can all hear you.
Victoria doesn't collaborate.
Yes, but we do.
The key people in Victoria don't collaborate.
No. But we're okay. So I want to push back a little bit. Let's push into this notion that the key people in Victoria don't collaborate. So I think that statement, and I'm just going to push back a little bit, Kelly, and I feel like I can do that because I know you. By saying the key people, we're giving our power away.
Yeah.
Because every single person in this room is a key person in Victoria.
Wrong,
so I know what you're saying.
We need to collaborate more.
Collaborate more.
Yeah.
Okay.
Apologize for that.
Yeah.
We need the right people
in the right room talking. Right. Like what you're saying.
We're actually working on that right now.
Yes.
We have a committee right now that is working on developing, I don't even know, it's such in the beginning stages. We went to a Volunteer Victoria thing called Building Relationships with Funders.
Everyone hear her?
Sorry.
Just want to make sure everyone can hear.
So we went to an event that was Building Relationships with Funders because a lot of people were needing sponsorship, needing fundraisers, they were event planners and stuff. One of the things that the British Columbia government has is money to put into a collaboration group. And Victoria has a lot of events and a lot of event planners, and they're all doing their own things. And our idea was to get them and some of the businesses and stuff like that together to co-promote everybody without spending any more money.
A collaboration lab.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Victoria needs a collaboration,
exactly.
A living lab.
Yeah.
All right, our friend up here wanted to say something.
Yeah, just like in addition to that great suggestion, I think that where creative thought and making already happens and where money already sits, that's the people that intrinsically just have to sit together more often. Like I was in a meeting this morning, I make a regularly, like Monday's mindfulness meeting happen between all the studios that want to participate or all the people who provide those kind of workshops and events and services, because once you sit together in a room and that frequently, you actually also networking, you said, right? I think it's like you actually just get to know the person.
Yeah.
And with that, you want to be helping them.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, okay, yeah, we're going to go back here, and then I've got a question again for the folks. Yeah, go ahead.
I feel like it's talking about how we can create together rather than what is wrong. Focusing on what we can actually do to build to create a better society, rather than saying, well, that's wrong, and this is wrong, and this is happening, and
focusing on the positive versus
the
negative.
I'm gonna build on some of the things we've heard here, and then turn this question back to the panel. And some people who know me have heard me say this before. Actually, I'll tell it as an anecdote, because it wasn't originally my idea, and I want to give the credit where the credit's due. So I was talking to a young guy who moved here from Guelph probably a couple years ago now, and we had coffee again. This was about a year ago, and he said he was forewarned that Victoria is a place with a very high talk to action ratio. We love to talk, I know, that's our reputation. And I think I think that's part of what we're hearing. So we can have an unexpected conversation every week. We can have a networking event every night. But I want to know from you folks who are taking action, I want to know how do you, and give us a concrete story if you can, how do you turn a conversation that you've had with somebody, how do you turn that into action that's going to change the world, that's going to sell your product, that's going to, whatever it is, how do you take something, and as specific as possible, take something from a conversation, a network, into action?
So you
want to
start?
Sure.
You're gesturing for the microphone.
You have to excite them. You have to create that motivation through. It's excitement. You know, that's what we've been doing here for the last little while. You have people walking in the door, and you show them around, and they're kind of excited. They think it's really cool. But then to get them to actually act and actually start to produce something, you have to instill that dream inside of their mind. Otherwise, they're just going to leave and go, well, that was cool. And then they're going to forget about it in a week.
I don't know if that's enough, because there's this access problem. Like, you're really privileged to have found this amazing space, and you're definitely leveraging it in all the ways you can, and it's really impressive and amazing. And I'm lucky enough to live in a house that we rent where there's a big workshop, and I can have some woodworking tools, and I can... But if I lived in an apartment, you know, that wouldn't be able to happen. So, as far as just, like, the maker movement goes and making things, there's an access issue that if you're not privileged enough to have access, where do you kind of get going? I know that there's the maker space, you know, you can pay a monthly fee.
Yeah, we're actually members there. It's been huge.
Yeah, and that's great. And they're blowing up all around the country.
Yeah.
And they have things like CNCs and laser cutters. And but as far as like city sponsor, like how does the city of Victoria help fund this and or help, you know, makers make things? Maybe it's something like that, because access is a big problem, I think.
That you bring up a good point, though. The maker space, it's too far away from downtown. And if you took a portion of the budget for like the library system, and you put that into a new technology center, and you gave people, you still pay a fee, whatever, it's added onto your, you know, your membership. And you could go into the library and print something. You could go learn how to make something. You could go take a class. All of a sudden, you just opened up a whole new, like, that would be the best allocation of resources for a government to put, I'm losing my words here. If you were to do that, it would be better than just giving a grant. Because you would empower people to learn how to make something, give them business classes.
I'm really, really glad that you just said that word, because that's exactly what I'm going to talk about, and it's empowerment. So you asked the question, you know, how do you take people from conversation to action? And so I totally agree with Andrew in terms of excitement. You need to excite people with your ideas. But anybody can get excited about it. I get excited 72 times a day. There's always something that I'm excited about. I'm just that kind of person, as I'm sure you can tell from my wild hand gestures. So when I think about how do you take people from excitement to action, so everyone I speak to about what I'm doing, what I'm making, what I'm creating, what I'm thinking about, they get excited as well. But how do I then take them to the next step? Because excitement, as Mark said, is often not enough, especially when we live in a relatively apathetic society. And here's the other thing I'm going to put out there, and hopefully it's not going to lose me any friends in the room, but Victoria's a really nice place to live. You know, there's a reason that, you know, all of the best literature in the world came out of Russia. You know, it's cold. It's crappy. Nobody wants to live there. Everybody wants to live here because it's beautiful and it's mild. And when there is no conflict, sometimes great things can't happen. Does that make sense?
Totally. You know what, actually, can I pick up on that for a sec?
Yeah, please do.
So I was asked to give the keynote address at the Chamber of Commerce. They always ask the mayor, so they didn't actually pick me. They just picked the person who was the mayor, and which happened to be me this year. And one of the things, you know, the thesis of my talk was that our biggest problem is that we live in paradise.
Yeah.
And I think that is probably part of the challenge that we've had. We live in paradise. We have no sense of urgency because it's already perfect here. And more importantly, I think We don't want to take a chance and try anything because we might ruin paradise, right? So look, the fact that we live in paradise is actually an impediment.
It totally is, and I always think about that when I think about all of my, you know, personal heroes. They all came from places that were, you know, or their lives were not paradise. And so when I think about, you know, what takes me from excitement to action, I think about a little bit of conflict, which is great. We live on an island. There's a finite number of people and a finite number of resources. There's our conflict. But again, we're Canadian, and we're a little bit apathetic, so we're like, oh, whatever, it's fine, nobody's gonna do it, whatever, let's go to the beach, right? Let's go over here.
Let's get in our kayaks.
Yeah, let's get in our kayaks.
There's right? a phrase, yeah. I've heard a phrase recently, kayak o'clock.
Yeah, right? And so, the next step for me was, you know, not just getting people excited about what I was doing, but getting them excited about causes that they believe in as well. So you will find attached to the maker movement is the cause movement. And this is the idea that all of us that are actually making a living off of being a maker can also use our platform to support causes that we believe in. And this is something that we're great at in Victoria. There are like, what, 172 networking groups that are out there. And each one of them has a cause attached to them that they love. And I love that. So wherever I'm going, whoever I'm meeting, whoever I'm talking to, I get to talk about the causes that I love. And then attached to it is this little business that I have. And so that is how I personally am taking people from excitement to action. Because not only am I doing something that I'm exceptionally passionate about, I want to help the world by being sustainable. I want to help the world by, actually, I love that you said cradle to cradle earlier, because I have several products that are cradle to cradle. Have you seen the TED Talk? You got to watch the TED Talk on cradle to cradle. It's awesome. It'll blow your mind. But it's taking it that one step further to now, I'm doing good by making something, I'm doing good by talking about it and exciting you about it, we're doing good by helping people, and if you help me, then we can change the world we live in.
Okay, oh, she's gonna cry again.
I know.
I can feel it. Okay, yeah, let's go back out here for some thoughts. Yeah, Sonia.
I have an answer because I work in the place where I encounter lots of people's ideas. Lisa experiences in the campaign, great ideas. And I've learned to be very, very crass in getting commitment from people before the conversation ends.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And I mean contact information, and then you need to be willing to follow up and ask, and making the ask, frankly. And then people are busy, and recognizing that when people don't get back to you right away, it's probably because they're busy, not so much because they've lost interest. But I think that's the thing, is that we have these really good, feel-good conversations. And then we walk away, nobody's responsible for the next step. So I've learned in a very crass business kind of way to walk away with the next step and an action item. And it sounds corporate, but that's what you need to do.
Yeah, you need to be, in order to get things done, you need to be really pushy. Yeah. Like I came into this space, these guys invited me for a tour, and before I left, we were organizing this event. Now, you know,
you are pushy.
I know, but look, we're here, we're getting something done. And then Sarah, who I forgot to mention at the beginning, Sarah's been an absolute champion. And that's the other thing about getting things done. Something needs a champion, right? Like I've done what I can do, print the cards and this and that, but these guys built the website pro bono. It says all over Designed by Studio Robazo, and they'll say that forever. So they built the website, they hosted the space. You know, I got the beer and paid for the sound equipment, but they arranged everything. The chairs came from some, you know, Sonia, someone who helped out on my campaign. So it's basically a crowdsourced event, but there was a champion, and that champion was Studio Robazo and Sarah. So in addition to being pushy, in addition to getting a commitment, you need to find a champion. And realistically, I don't think we can all be the champions of everything. So finding those community champions.
I just wanted to tack on to my previous statements because I'm not crying now. and I love was it Joanne?
Sonia,
I'm sorry, Sonia, I love what Sonia said, but I have to add something to it. You need to get the commitment and you need to ask, right? You always need to ask for help, ask for what you need, ask for someone to hold your hand, and ask for me is always speak kindly, and that's the way that you get people to do things for you, is because they're not doing it for you, they're doing it with you when you ask them. So that's a little tidbit.
Yeah. It's a Victoria problem, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's hear from Mark.
I was just gonna say, I don't think that's a Victoria problem. Getting people to commit to things and making action items. It seems to be like a human thing, just in general, right?
So how do you crack that in your work? How do you get things done? How do you do four jobs at once?
Oh man, juggling. What was it? There's like the saying about when you're learning to juggle, you're really just learning to pick balls up off the floor. And so you just kind of get used to that. And when you're picking them up, you're like, this is what I'm learning to do. And you kind of get better at it. I don't know. I'd really love to not be doing four jobs, to be straight up honest with you. But you got to do what you got to do.
Which one did you pick?
Oh, I love the making. I mean, it's obviously the most
good.
Creative.
Yeah, that's good. It for us.
Yeah.
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 Well, I agree with him completely about the fact that it might not even just be a Victoria thing. It might be actually a global thing nowadays, just because we live in a world right now where you don't have as much accountability being on the web all the time. You can say whatever you want. You can throw in an idea. And you're not held responsible, really. But by asking questions, by ensuring that a person is going to meet you and do this and that, and holding them accountable, holding them responsible, all of a sudden you put it on them. And maybe our generation, the newest generation, isn't used to that as much, or is just used to being able to get away with just having ideas and just being the observer at the same time. But having that accountability is so important. And also that factors in with the fact that we do need to still have the old-fashioned networking. Because having that physical presence, when you're face to face with a person, you're that much more accountable as well at the same time.
Yeah, the people I meet for projects face to face, those are the projects that happen.
Yeah.
The people that send me a random email, can you do this? I may never hear from again, even if I follow up with them, right? But there, I think there is something about the face to face that really, in my experience so far, gets that ball going.
Because you're handsome.
Yeah.
You, you were actually able to get them in the room. You know, this brings up the whole idea of when you didn't have a cell phone and you said you were going to go somewhere, you had to do it. Otherwise, you're a terrible person for standing them up. But now, it could be 5 minutes before you're supposed to be there, and then you can. Oh, you know, actually, I don't want to do this. And then you just send a text message to say no. No, but that that's what we're breeding. So you're totally right. This is not just a Victoria thing. This is a global problem. And it's going to just keep growing and growing.
Well, I think it's double-sided. Because, like, the information of being able to connect with each other allowed me to build a robot in
the
garage.
Yeah.
Right? You know, so, like, it's responsible use of that technology. Not to shun your friends.
Yeah.
You know, to make things happen.
That's good.
Not
that's good.
For shunning your friends anyway.
Yeah, right.
Treat that.
Okay, yeah, another comment from the floor here.
So there's two things I'd like to mention. Again, being new to Victoria, I have to ask a lot. And I'm curious, when did asking become pushy? I just learned, I don't know when it was at a very early age, but if you want anything in life, you bloody well have to ask for it. It's not going to just pop into your lap. And if you build relationships with people, if you have a relationship with someone that you've nurtured and you've worked on, why wouldn't you ask them? And that is definitely one of the problems that I've seen in Victoria, and it's one of the things that for me, when I got here, I didn't know anyone, I didn't have a job, I came here from Australia, from living in Australia for a year. I didn't have a place to live, and I had to ask for all of those things getting off the ferry, and I basically had everything I needed within 2 weeks. But I had to put myself out there, and I had to say what I needed and be very open, and I had to ask for it. And I don't think that that's pushy.
So you know what, let's take your question really, really seriously. I wanna ask, I mean, it's a brilliant question. When did asking become pushy?
I'm gonna field this one
because this is what I'm all about here. I totally understand. I've been in that situation numerous times in my life. And asking became pushy when we became so disconnected from each other.
Wow.
I am such an advocate for the internet. I love what a globalization is happening in the world. I love that we know what is happening in places we've never been. I love that places who, you know, they barely even knew that Canada existed now know about us. I think that's amazing. But what we are losing is this ability to be vulnerable.
You know, now I'm
and
crying.
That's, I know, but that's what asking is. When you're... When you are asking for something, you are showing yourself. That is what you're doing. You're saying, I need. And in this day, it is not okay to need. We are supposed to have everything from birth. We are supposed to come out with all the tools we need to live in the world without ever needing to touch another human being. And so this is why it is so hard for us to do it. And this is one of the things that, that we are trying to create. That's part of what the movement is all about, is this idea that when I need something, I have to ask. And I've never been afraid to ask. And I'm
that's
also deemed
pushy. That's because you're connected. But I mean, the reason your answer made me cry is the fact that it's hard to ask because we're fundamentally disconnected from each other.
Always, yeah. But you have to, but it starts with you, right? And just like you said, when you got off the ferry, you had to ask.
Yeah.
And that's because you allowed yourself to be vulnerable and to connect with someone else. And you asked the question and you got your answer. And I've often found, and this is the bonus for being someone who does ask, is you usually get what you need.
Exactly.
Right, and it may not. So there is. It's a double side. It's a double edged sword. You need to get over yourself a little bit. You need to expose yourself a little bit to ask for what you need. But often, because you've been so bold, you'll get it.
Yeah. I think what's the worst thing that could happen?
They're gonna lie to you.
Really? What's the worst?
That's what? That's the worst.
We're afraid
thing.
Of no. All right, over to Mark. Why are we afraid to ask?
I don't know. I was just gonna say that I think you could probably replace the word ask with communicate.
Yes.
And all the things you just said, and so. I mean, there's a lot of different ways to ask something. And communication is the glue that bonds us all together, right? So, you know, you got here and you communicated with people and yeah. Asking, I don't know, I don't think I have that much of a problem asking for things. My girlfriend might be able to comment on that. But yeah, also I think I'm pretty lucky to be who I am and born who I was. And I don't really have any fear when I'm walking around. Or anything like that, and I know it's not like that for everybody, so.
We're very privileged.
We're very privileged, yeah.
Andrew, do you want to add anything on asking? Good, okay, there was a thought, oh, yeah. Oh, actually, here, oh, yeah, go ahead. No, someone ask us.
I'm just curious how many people have a problem asking in here.
Hands up with if you got a problem asking.
You've got
to work. A little less than 50%.
I have a problem answering.
Yeah, great question. Who has a problem answering? Anyone?
No.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, but if they have that problem, wouldn't they not raise their hand right now?
Yeah.
Good. Yes, at the back.
Hi there. I'd just like to add another element to that. I'm a fairly new entrepreneur as well. And I think something that I've learned for myself is that you have to be resilient and be okay with no.
Yeah.
Right? And I think a part of being a maker is just realizing what you make for yourself and what you can share with others is it's the bonus. And as you can kind of hit, I guess, face head on the no's, you'll get through, and no's are victories as much as yeses.
Absolutely. Yeah. It gets you closer to the yes.
Yeah. Jason, do you want to add something?
Yeah, just in the domain of no's, I love that one. And like, the degree to which you can take a no is completely consistent with the size of the question you can ask.
Yes.
You know,
ooh,
if you can take a massive no, you can say, can I have your car for the weekend?
Yeah.
Can I be your business partner? Can I take you to dinner? And you'll notice that our perception of the size of the no tends to invert, like reverse engineer the size of the question we're willing to put into that space.
Yeah.
And so becoming okay with no completely like creates your ability to ask the big questions in the first place.
And it's also not taking it personally.
Yeah.
They're not personally attacking you, saying that you're less of a person. I think these are big things that we need to do. We have to heal our inner kind of child to be able to do these things, because otherwise you're just gonna crawl away in a little hole.
Yeah.
And you're not gonna go out into the day again.
Not to pick on the internet again, but a lot of this did start with the idea that if I post something and no one likes it, I am not worthy, right? So how am I able to take a no when I can't even handle that nobody liked my Facebook status yesterday? Luckily, I don't have that problem.
Yes, over there.
So what I hear is I think a lot of people have fear to ask. But then I also think the person who is being asked has fear as well to respond.
Yes.
Yeah. And to continue to respond and continue to actually make the connection, right? And so I feel like that is the main disconnect.
Absolutely. And I think one of the things that I feel like I'm learning in this conversation, if I didn't know it already, it's being reaffirmed, is the very most important thing we can do to support each other as makers, as entrepreneurs, as people who are working with entrepreneurs, whatever it is, that the most important thing that we can do is actually keep staying and getting connected. It's so simple. It's utterly simple. And if we have that connection, we can get a yes, or we can get a no and be okay with it. We can borrow the car for the weekend, we can take someone to dinner, we can do whatever it is, as long as we have that connection and that sense of belonging. And maybe that's, you know, if it wasn't obvious to me before, it's sure obvious now. Over here, and then I got some more. One more big question for you guys, and actually it's gonna seem like I made it up, but it was the one question I actually thought of in advance that I'm gonna end with, comes directly from what's here, even though I thought about it in advance, if that makes any sense. Okay, over there.
Okay. Well, just going on to what you were just saying about maintaining that connection. And I feel like there's these two opposites that we're trying to bridge here and that we're trying to maintain as people, as a species. And it's the fact that we've become so interconnected on a virtual level, but we also need to maintain connection on a physical human level. So to maintain the balance of those two, having those old school values of asking, of being direct, of, you know, being an open person, but then having the new school values of being technologically savvy and interconnected in every way and staying on top of the latest technology. So bringing that balance of those two extremes is very important when it comes to that connection.
Yeah, for sure. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, sure. So I think Victoria is actually doing really well in that regard. To be honest with you, like, I'm running a business since 2 years, and arrived 2 years ago, grew up in Europe. And it is such a phenomenal place, not just a paradise in terms of the nature and the scenery and the landscape and all the great tourists that bring a lot of flow as well. It's the people itself. And the fact that we have unexpected conversations like this one, and we're streaming it or at least recording it so we have it on YouTube, means we're going to places that consciousness hasn't been before, regularly in a collective group, and that's great. So we just keep doing what we do, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So the final question, it is the only question that I thought in advance, you know, when I woke up this morning, what do I want to ask? And really it goes back to the very fundamental reason that I convened this Unexpected Conversation series, which is to create new connections, new ventures, new solutions, and so on. And so I'm going to ask this question at the end of every Unexpected Conversation. And the question is this. The question is, in your making life, in your business venture, what do you want to do? What's your wildest dream? And how can these folks here, very specifically, how can they help you? That's the question to each of you. What's your wildest dream? Where do you want to go next? And very specifically, what do you need? What's your ask to get there? And then I'm going to send us all off to drink beer. And if you've got answers, if you got things that you can help with for each of these specific folks and their answers, then that's over to you. So what's your wildest dream and how can we help? Well, whoever wants to go first.
Well, I'm gonna cry.
You can't cry. You're not allowed to cry.
That is a very big question, but I know the answer, which is nice, because I often don't know the answer when I'm asked a question and I have to think about it. What I want, and that is my, at the very core of the company that I started, is to empower people to create a space where they can be confident and make healthy choices. That is what Elate as a company is all about. Our mission statement, our mantra, everything in all of the literature that I ever put out is all about building confidence through kindness. That's who I am as a person, and that's what I do with my business. I am a cosmetic company that is less concerned with selling cosmetics than I am with selling empowerment. I want everyone who ever watches one of my videos or sees something that I've done or comes to an event or purchases a lipstick to feel not only like they didn't need it, but that they love that it is good for them, good for the environment, and then by using it, they actually become a more whole and more confident person.
So that's your wildest dream. How can we help you?
How can you help me with that? You can help me by in person just saying hello and letting me know that you have seen something I've done and that it has touched you in some way. That's so incredibly fulfilling. And that actually happens to me now. I was telling the guys earlier today that, you know, I feel like a celebrity when someone comes up to me and says that they follow me on Instagram, or, you know, that my videos make them cry or something like that. And also, you know, just sharing virtually, sharing the content, sharing the message, because that's what it's all about. And I think that that is at the heart of what the movement is about. It's you know, it's not necessarily about the end result or the end product. It's about the process, and it's about the emotion that we're trying to invoke, and it's about the things that we're trying to do to do better things in our local community and around the world.
Thank you. Mark, what's your why with red? Okay, Mark, what's your wildest dream? What do you want to do in the next 10 years, and how can we help you?
Okay.
The collective
week. It's a big question.
Yeah, it's a big, but you got a big people, a big series of people, yeah, to help answer.
I would love to quit a couple jobs. I think that the things that I bring to the table could really help some other local businesses bring even more to the table. And so what I would like to see is, yeah, to be able to focus on the things I'm more passionate about and get rid of the things that I'm less passionate about. And the way that you guys could help me would probably be to kind of question the status quo. And I'm guessing that since you guys are in this room, you probably are already the people who do that. But you see something that's broken and you think, I can't get this part. Maybe somebody can make it. And just changing your thinking in that way might lead you to, you know, Googling CNC maker in Victoria, and you might find me or someone else who's built their own CNC. I think just the more people question the status quo that we, the disposable culture that we're trying to break free from, is really going to help people like me succeed to be able to quit the jobs I don't enjoy doing and do the stuff that I love. So.
Thank you. And I did not know what CNC meant before this conversation, so now I do. And when I need a part for my washing machine, I'm going to call you. What's your wildest dream?
Wildest dream.
Next 10 years, what are you going to do, and how can we help you?
I want to see what we're trying to cultivate here be able to be an exportable product itself. The idea of being able to simultaneously give people the space to express themselves, meanwhile being able to merge that with design, being able to offer products simultaneously, I think has a huge potential outside of the city. I don't know where I can go to get that, except for going to maybe a Muji store where you're surrounded by these beautiful products. You get to the very end and they'll design your house. But it doesn't allow you to convene and come together and collaborate simultaneously, and that's what I want to see. It's like finding that perfect balance between, one word I've been using lately is, how do you create a multinational local business?
That's a great question.
Right? That's what I want to see answered, because that's where it needs to go. So.
All right, well, we'll leave that as a main question. How do you create a multinational local business? Okay, so before I turn everyone loose to help these folks out with their wildest dreams, I'll invite each of you also to, as you're having conversations, to share your wildest dreams with each other. In the spirit of what's happened here, I'll also invite, and again, it's an invitation, it's not an assignment, I'll invite each of you to ask something of someone who's here tonight, big or small, invitation to ask something of someone who's here tonight as we hang out, enjoy the sunshine that's streaming in through the beautiful skylights and some delicious local beer. I do want to do a plug for conversation number two, curating community, and that's Thursday, October the 22nd at the Bauman Center, which is this unconventional, unexpected space recently restored by the Opera. And there we'll be talking about curating community with people from the tech sector, the theater community, and the small business community. So we'll see what happens there. Conversations three and four, yet to be determined, over to you to help me out with that. This is going to be up on YouTube, as someone said. My ask is, share this conversation. I think, you know, it's been a good one. So once this is up on YouTube, tweet it, Facebook it, share it. and really let's try and build this unexpected movement into something that turns, as we've all determined, into action. Anyone who wants to talk to Jason and say anything at all on video, if you feel inspired, he'll take your comments. And maybe the four of us could just hang here for just a minute, and Jason wants to ask us a question collectively, or he wants to do some weird, unexpected thing that Jason does. Thank you very much for coming. Enjoy the beer. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
That was incredible to witness how so many people would be in the same room, all thinking and feeling the exact same way. And while there were differences, there was a commonality that binded us all together to allow for a dialogue to come together to bring out and flesh out ideas that were hidden on the surface. And that for me was really important.
Yes, you should come to an unexpected conversation just for exactly what the title denotes, an unexpected conversation, to be inspired and to feel really happy to be in your community.
Awesome, thank you.
Oh, hang on. To feel inspired and to participate in your community.
That's better. That's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Down here? Yeah, that was really fun. It was really great to hear the audience engage in a conversation and to be not sure where it was going to end up, and to really kind of find out how many people in the same room were on the same page. I feel a lot of inspiration right now, and it's the type of inspiration you can't get from watching a video. You got to go out and you got to be in it to feel it.
I'm Andrew Azzopardi here at Studio Robazzo. We just hosted the Unexpected Conversations, first conversation actually. We are a holistic lifestyle design studio, trying to understand how to merge multiple disciplines to create absolutely new things. So for instance, right behind us, this is our yoga studio and workshop studio, where we host innovative classes and workshops all the time. Downstairs, we also have our photography studio and a massage studio, if you will. And in the very, very back, we have our design studio. All of these things for us come together to compose a complete whole, to offer an alternative for people to buy into, or for them to come together and feel the power of how, when you merge things together, they create brand new things.
I'm Mayor Lisa, and I created this Unexpected Conversation series because there is so many amazing things going on in Victoria, in tech, in art, in tourism, in making, in music, and we're doing all these awesome things, and everyone else in the world knows about them, but we don't know about them. And so the whole point of Unexpected Conversations is to bring people together who wouldn't otherwise be sitting together, unexpected, and ask them questions, and invite the people who come to ask questions, have a conversation. And really the point isn't just more talk, we've got lots of talk in Victoria. The point is new solutions, new collaborations, new enterprises. We don't know, it's unexpected. First one went well, and yeah, I'm thrilled. I'm thrilled with the series, and it's only day one.
Thank you.